The title is "What is 1 kilogram plus 0.1 meters?" In programs, you can easily make a summation like that. And of course, this is something you want to prevent from happening. So let's consider this further. In almost all programs, you can encounter units and dimensions of measurement are playing a role most of the time invisibly. So you have to take care that you do the right things with units and don't calculate 1 kilogram plus 0.1 meter. Such a thing, if you write it out, is very easy to spot. But if you take an example like the one over here, let me get a nice pointer here. Well, probably you spot the difficulty here. The radius is raised to the power 2 rather than 3. And that's a very simple example, which probably leaps out right away. I have been in recent past looking at programs which use units in a much less conspicuous way, and was very difficult to figure out what was going on and whether everything was done in the right way. And my message is that such mistakes are not always easy to spot, and we need programming tools. And I'll present together with Brett one possibility for that. If we go on, if you look at units and dimensions, well, dimensions we work with as physicists and chemists, length, mass, you name it, all the ones from the Système International. But also, if you look at other domains, population size, the amount of money, there's a wide variety of dimensions going around. And each dimension has one or quite often a whole host of units that you want to measure your quantities in. For instance, meters versus foot, kilometer versus mile, so the SI units versus the imperial units, but also things which are more the household kinds of units, seconds versus hours versus days, or amounts of dollars for 1 euro, or vice versa. And it's of course quite important to get the right ratio in that case. Often, and perhaps always, you'll find there is a linear relationship between different units. A meter is about 3 feet, something like that. But it is important to get these numbers right, to get these relationships right. There's one snag, and that is if you look at temperature. Consider, for instance, a temperature like this in degrees centigrade. If you were to convert this temperature and this temperature to Kelvin, you would get something like this, which is of course nonsense. So in this case, you have to be careful that a temperature can be added to a temperature difference or vice versa. But you can't simply add two temperatures, because then you get something nonsensical. So there are all kinds of difficulties involved using dimensions and using units, and you have to be fairly careful that you do the right thing. So here again, you can see the need for a set of tools that we need. And programming tools have been around for quite some time to take care of these sort of things. But when Brett and I started to work on our paper about it, one thing we noted was that these tools come with documentation that presents the solution, but they never tell you what it can do with that, whether there are limitations, whether certain usage patterns are impossible or not. And I will show you some styles of things that that can be done with these tools. And in the paper, you'll find some usage patterns which may or may not be possible if you go for these tools. In general, we have seen something like four different categories. One is a strictly strict definition of units that you use for the variables. That will be my first example. Another one is that you define the variables to have a certain dimension, length, a mass, you name it. And then the tool will provide automatic conversions for the units that you use. That is quite useful. On the other hand, you get a wide variety of dimensions, and the library, and we'll see an example of that, has to take care of all these combinations. The next category, which is to track dimensions of variables while things are working, while your program is working, is something that is much less, has much less trouble with that sort of combinations, but it presents other difficulties. And the last category that we found is a category of tools that present static analysis and infer the units or dimensions with or without help of the programmer, which is of course a very nice tool as well, because then you don't have to worry about annotating your variables or defining the right dimensions at the start. The tool will do that for you, and if you make a mistake, then it will tell you where the mistake was. So those are four categories, and now let's have a look at the examples. Here is an example, and that's from Van Snyder's proposal for Fortran. What you do is you define the units you want to use. Foot, second. Here a unit for the velocity, feet per second. So you can do some simple arithmetic here. And via this attribute, unit foot, you say that distance is a measure of length, and that the unit you want to use is foot. This kind of thing allows for compile time checking. So the location of trouble is immediately clear, and you can make amends for that in the code. A disadvantage that you will find is how to make these libraries, library routines generic. Because say you want to solve a set of ordinary differential equations, you can have a general algorithm for that put into a general routine. But of course, the dependent variables and the independent variable that you pass to it may have different units. And so the library has to be generic in some way. And still you want to keep track of whether the units are used in the right way. So that's the difficulty. And one thing that is quite attractive as far as the proposal by Snyder is concerned is that it does make a solution possible for that. I won't go into details. The presentation is too short for that. But we do discuss it in the paper we are preparing. Next one, defining the dimensions of your variables, and that can be done given the library by Brad Richardson in a style like this. You define a type which is of which has a dimension length. The library makes sure that all the allowed operations are there. So a length dim can be combined with a density dim, And when the proper arithmetic is used, you get a mass, things like that. So you define in advance what the dimensions are of all your variables. The advantage is that you have a fairly limited set of quantities and dimensions to worry about. It's clear where in the code things may go wrong. But you do have to think about how to use the units. And the library, in this case, Coff, has to deal with all kinds of combinations. So that may involve a combinatorial explosion, especially if you go beyond the SI dimensions. Well, it's one style. Certainly something that can be useful and usable, and it doesn't require special special support from the language itself, other than having types and derived types and operations for these types. A very early solution I've seen about this by William Petty. That is that you use the dimensions of a variable, and you track these dimensions over time during the computation. So x1, for instance, is in meters. x2 is in meters per second, as expressed via these initialization statements. T in time, etc. We can solve the ordinary differential equations which are involved via this function that doesn't need to do anything special except take these type of variables, and we write it out like this. And the advantage here is that you don't have to deal with different types. There's just one type which has all the dimensions in it. Of course, you limit yourself to dimensions that you have predefined. And a much more important problem is if an error occurs, then it is not immediately clear where it happens. Because you could assign, say, a mass to this particular parameter variable. And then somewhere inside this routine, mass has to be combined, added to meters, and things go wrong. So you don't have the possibility to check exactly where the origin occurs, the problem occurs, and that makes this kind of things a bit awkward to use. On the other hand, it's a fairly lightweight library. So if nothing else is suitable, then certainly try and do this something like this. Static analysis, so the last part of this set. In that case, the actual code is analyzed by a tool, here a tool by Contrastin called Kempfort. In this case, you have some annotations for the various variables, and here we have here we set the values. We do some calculations, and thanks to the tool and thanks to the annotations you put in as a user, it is checked that potential energy does indeed have a unit which is an energy unit, and that this particular expression is correct in terms of units. The nice thing about that is that you don't have to do too much to your source code. Units are inferred from the code itself, and perhaps from some annotations you do. On the other hand, these annotations are not part of your code, so it's very easy to forget about them. And these annotations will get stale certainly if you don't use such an analysis tool all the time, which means that after some time, you get a discrepancy between these annotations and the actual meaning of these statements. So that's a drawback of using static analysis tools. And so all things considered, all these things are possible, but these tools have different pros and cons. And summarizing that, they also differ in the kinds of things they allow to your code. For details, I refer to our paper. Not much more to be said about this here, but they also differ in the impact on your code if you want to use them correctly. And they also differ in what kind of language support is needed. So in the current state, quite a few of these tools are quite useful and usable, except for the unit attributes I showed as the first example. But on the other hand, that is the most certain way we've seen to provide real units within Fortran. It provides a robust and also flexible solution. And even if not all typical users are supported, it does provide, as far as we're concerned, an important new tool to make sure that your program is doing the right things as far as units and dimensions are concerned. Well, that's my presentation. I'll stop sharing now.
Thank you very much, Arjen. We have time for one, maybe two quick questions. So if you want to ask the question live, please use the raise hand feature or just unmute and ask. Otherwise, we got some questions incoming on the channel. One is, what about, or did you look at the performance impact of the different approaches?
Well, that's certainly an important aspect. And that's something where these tools also differ. The one we propose to look into from a serious point of view, so the proposal by Snyder, that has no impact on performance, or almost no impact, because it's mostly annotation in the source code. And once the compiler has done its work, in runtime, nothing or almost nothing is needed. Other tools do have a drawback in that respect, especially if you track the dimension at runtime. That's overhead that can be ameliorated for a bit, but there is an impact. And that's certainly something we have been looking into. I saw Brett answering quite a few other questions.
Yes, yes. The discussion is already going on over there.
Good.
So if it's okay for you, we will take it on with the next speaker.
Okay.
Thank you very much again, Arjen.
You're welcome.
Looking forward
to it. It's a fascinating subject. That is the least I can say about it.